Before we get into the episode, just a little content warning here that the book Amygdalatropolis and our conversation cover some really kind of heavy themes. Anything we want to add to that?
Yeah, we don't know what an amygdala is.
We now know what an amygdala is, but when we recorded the episode, we did not know what amygdala is.
Partially because I refused to let Joey Google it.
But we got it wrong, so enjoy. Hello and welcome to How to Win the Lottery, Season 3, Internet Module, Amygdalatropolis by B.R. Yeager. I'm Joey Lewandowski.
I'm glad that you said the name of the book, because this is every time I say it in my head, I mess it up.
I can say it easily. Every time I type it, I'm like, I have to very slowly, because it's like, the word amygdala is complicated enough on its own to type, and then you add in a fake word, you make it a fake word, and there's a lot going on.
And what is the amygdala?
What is the amygdala? It's a part of the brain. Is that before I Google it? Is that,
don't Google it. There's an official ban on you Googling stuff in the middle of the show.
Okay, I think it regulates self control. Is that right?
I don't know.
Oh, I think that's what it does.
Okay,
should I Google it?
No.
Okay.
This is what we'll go with.
Next week we're gonna be talking to B.R. Yeager, the author of this, which is very exciting. But yeah, this was one that you had not read this one
before. I hadn't read it. I'd read, I know B.R. Yeager through, how did I know about this? So I think he has a book out with a press called Inside the Castle, which is a very like hyper experimental press that often does really interesting things with the way that text is laid out on the page, and
which this does too,
like really interesting things structurally with books. So that the books are like they're books for adults, obviously, but like there is an illustrative quality in much in the way that like children's books appeal to children, in the way that like they're with much more regards to layout and things because kids are processing imagery. And then I think that at some point we forget that or we like portion that off into this idea that like that kind of thing is for children, which it's not. It's still very much appealing to adults when they're reading, because you process things in a much, much different way. You know, you get used to, like, I'm reading Great Expectations by Charles Dickens. Holy shit, is it a slog. It's just like...
Is it long?
It's like 450 pages.
Okay, right? So it's long, but it's not crazy long.
Longish, but it's like very Victorian and traditional, and the paragraphs are long and they're not broken up. Yep. And so you're staring down these enormous blocks of text, mm-hmm. which has an aesthetic... an intimidating aesthetic for a reader. Like, you just look at it and without even processing what any of those words mean,
it's daunting.
Yeah, you like ingest the concept in a very like intimidating and distracting way. And this content, Amygdalatropolis, this is a schism book. I'm not familiar with that.
I can't even find them online.
It might be his press.
That's what. So you know, my co-host over on Too Fast, Too Forever lives in the New Haven area, and this was printed in North Haven. I'm like, hey, the book we're reading, you know, around the corner. And he looked them up. He can find them. I'm like, it might just be a guy in a garage.
It might be a guy in a garage, which is great. I mean, that's even like I love that. What's that noise?
That's a guy outside doing yard work. Nothing we can control.
Son of a gun. So I think
we're putting our amygdalas to the test here. Maybe if it does what I think
that's it what does. It does. We're going to find out that it, like, regulates spinal fluid or something like that, and it has nothing to do with anything. Where was I? Where actually was I? Okay.
You were talking about the Great Expectations being daunting, or not. Maybe I was applying
that. No, it certainly is. And I don't think that it's hard on a word-by-word basis, on a content basis. I don't think it's hard so much
Great
as...
Great Expectations.
Yeah. So much as it's long and boring. Which I don't
by design or just because
it's
old.
It's not by design. Right. Okay. It's not even because it's old. There's something about it that doesn't press any of my buttons. Mm-hmm. It doesn't like scratch any of the itches that I need scratched. These books, whether it be Amygdalatropolis or any of the other, like Mike Correa is a great writer that writes a lot of stuff for Inside the Castle. He wrote a book called Gut Text that's really phenomenal. These are books that I would say when you look at the page, it's really appealing because of the way the text is laid out. It draws you in a very specific, specific way that might even bring in people who aren't necessarily readers. Like, you look at it and you think, like, not only could I finish this book really quickly, because that is sort of appealing in its own way, being able to do like 70 pages in a day,
right,
or something like that.
Or I read the whole thing in a day. Yeah.
Okay.
Sorry to brag.
Show off.
Yeah. Sorry.
But you look at it and you think, like, this is not something that I've seen before, so it's fascinating, right. It's interesting. And then the content is incredibly fucking difficult.
Yeah.
And is really, really, especially in this case, really transgressive and violent and very much, like, it's a feel-bad book.
I think what also going to, before we talk about the content, about the actual stylistic structure, at one point toward the end, there's like narrative, and then there's sort of like third person, sort of like, even though it's all third person, but there's like even more third person, like in italics, like sort of like removed from the scene.
Yeah, that's not just in the end. That kind of,
well, like, I know, but then there's also like two or three different message board posts, and there's like left aligned and right aligned, and even maybe center aligned. And there's like there's four or five things happening on a single page, and I think only because of the way it's laid out are you able to keep that all straight.
Yeah, for sure, for sure. Yeah, there's something almost graphic designy about it that you don't, I think a lot of writers don't think about the way that the text looks on the page.
Yeah.
And I think more and more as our brains, as our amygdalas,
maybe
possibly sort of reorient themselves to process text through the internet and not so much novels, like we're more and more aware of and attracted to deviations from standard, the way books are standardly written, or, you know, authors are going to have to start thinking more and more about how the text looks on the page, because you have, when you design a website, you have to think about how the text looks on the page, right?
Well, I think, you know, what's interesting to me somewhat on the same topic is that this is not available as an ebook. This is only available.
Oh, in, that's great.
And I think part of that is because, like, I was tempted to type in one of the, because there's a lot of URLs in here that like redirect to like horrific shit. And I kind of want to be like, is this a real URL?
I doubt it.
And I
don't think it is.
But I think that there would be an easy temptation if you're on your computer reading on a Kindle or on your phone, and there's a link to like either a YouTube video or like, you know, some dark web Tor .onion link or whatever, to like click on that, be like, ooh, what is this? And like, I think he might have done this intentionally.
Sure. Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
To like steer you away from that.
Well, it also speaks to the thing that we, you know, we've talked about it a bunch of times, but just the thing that Darcy Wilder said in our interview with her, where she talks about how, you know, her book, because so much of it is about being on screens and being being like having your life sort of adjusted by the internet, that it was important to like return the book itself to a novelistic form, away from the ebook and the sort of screen dominated way to consume things.
Yeah. And I think that the other thing in terms of format, not about this book, is that I read Ducks Newburyport both in ebook and audiobook, but if I had the actual physical 1100 page, that's like just basically a block of text for that, like it would have been even more daunting, like on your phone or whatever, wherever you're reading it, it's hard to like actually flip through and be like, oh, this is all the same. Here you can like thumb through and be like, oh, I can actually fly through this, because like this page, for instance, I just like went, like there's like nothing on that, it's just, you can just go through it. So
yeah, it's interesting too that you bring up audiobooks, because that's another point to the importance of the way the text is laid out on the page, and the way that like this book is so much a novel in that it couldn't possibly translate to an audiobook, because what would the reader say, you know, /1404ER /(wed) and (1822-47) number, like you couldn't do it. It would drive you crazy. And the way that like YouTube links and things like that have a random assortment of numbers and letters and punctuation, like there's something that when we look at that on a page, our brains immediately like, we know what that is, and the randomness of it tied to the content of this book is frightening in a way that, that like, if you were saying it out loud, you would just be like, what, I don't understand, this is so stupid.
Right, because most of this book, so what this book is about is he starts off as 16 years old, an unnamed main character,
homeschooled,
who just goes by 1404ER, lives with his parents, is living an adult life to whatever extent that means at 16, because he's already graduated homeschool, and his parents, he's, you know, convinced, he's basically sequestered himself off in their former bedroom because he's like, I don't want to deal with you or the outside world.
And he needs an attached bathroom.
Yes, because he wants a private bathroom. And so he literally buys his parents out of their master bedroom by paying them off, but like lives at home and just doesn't see them or go out to the world. His mom drops off food. He doesn't see her, but just like lives his life online in a 4chan or 8chan kind of space where it's all these people like just trying to get off on like the most horrific shit imaginable. From what I understand, because I've never really spent time on these websites, but there's another podcast on our network, Hard to Believe, where my co-host from a different podcast, 1999 on the podcast. Anyway, John Brooks, who's the host of that, I do a show with him too, but he talked to the guy who like co-founded 8chan. And so he explained sort of the process of like how that actually works. And from what I remember, it's all anonymous because like it's just like a place for people to do their thing. Yeah. And so in this world, he's on a forum called 1404ER, which is what he calls himself, but everyone is 1404ER. And it doesn't matter who it is. And like you only signify that you're the person who started the thread by saying OP, an original poster. And it's just people going back and forth of like sharing snuff films and some harmless stuff or some not so harmless stuff.
Well, there's an interesting juxtaposition, I think, between the most horrific things that you can think of in the world, which is, you know, suicide videos, rape videos, massive disasters, just awful things happening, happening to people, with more, you know, interesting philosophical or technological questions. And that shows you that, you know, the people that are on this board have skills. They have things that they're able to think deeply about things, and it's not all homophobia and misogyny and all of these things. They also can speak fairly knowledgeably, as far as I know, because I don't have any knowledge about it, but about things like astronomy and about you know, tech stuff and things like that. Tech stuff makes sense because of the context.
I mean, it's just a matter of using your powers for good or evil, kind of, right? It's like they're all. There's a point in this where one of the posters is like, look, we all know what we are here. We're either fat virgins, skinny virgins, or there's a third category. It's like, I'm a fat virgin. And like, it's just the kind of thing where like they can all pretend that they're these like edgelords or whatever the word is. But at the end of the day, they're just kids who spend their entire life online. And like when you have the time, you're probably reading about things either good or bad, like either reading about astronomy or like how to lace water bottles with Rohypnol for whatever reason.
Well, there is, for whatever reason.
For one specific reason.
There are a lot of different reasons why you might want to lace water bottles. Anyway, like there is something fascinating. Like a lot of the tension to me in this book exists in what's real and what's not real, right? Because all of these people are online. There's one thread where it's like, how many people have you killed?
Right.
And some people are saying they did this. Some people are saying they did that. You get the sense that. And that might be the point where that person intervenes and says, look, we're all like one of three people here. And you get the sense that these people, for all of their fronting and for all of their, like, quote-unquote badness, they are all also lying.
Yeah, it's a facade.
Right? And they are, like, sort of living vicariously through these horrific events because those are the things that give them emotional spikes, right? Other than that, they're living in a an environment that does not have stimuli, right? They're you know, boxed in a room, not talking to people face to face, not feeling the sun. I mean, if we extrapolate and think of the main character as all of these characters, which we don't know which of them he is or which of them he's whether or not he's just
working.
I think
by design, right? Because
because it presents this collective view of the internet as this maybe very, very frightening place.
Well, I think also when there's actual real life versions of violence that are shared and like tagged, like you're on eBay selling a hard to find video game system, you like put your handle the thing. It's like, hey, 1404ER, like, look what I just did. And it's like a girl with her face bashed in with a wine bottle.
You get the sense that there are real ones. And when there are real ones, some people in the forum react the way that normal people would react. They're horrified and they would think, should we call the police on this? And then other people are like,
thanks for making this the best Valentine's Day ever.
Yeah. Those are people for whom the You know, I even hesitate to say real world because this is very much a real world for these people. It's like, mm-hmm. You know, the lived experience of being online has as many emotional highs and lows as whatever exists in the physical, going outside and playing sports and whatever. So I don't want to say real world, but it's kind of like world A and world B, each of which is as legitimate as the other. But what fascinates me about this is that the main character, 1404ER, 1404ER?
I don't know.
I keep, in my head,
I was thinking, like, 1404ER. Like, yeah, that's like, nice. Well, there's 404, like, because there's the error. I don't know what the
origin
is, but yeah.
Anyway, so he's agoraphobic. Mm-hmm. And a lot of his agoraphobia, you can attribute some of it to this idea of something that may or may not have happened where he was kidnapped and molested when he was younger.
By the Polish woman.
But there's like a sense that is sort of blurry to him. He's not sure how much of that is real or if any of it is real.
Right.
And maybe because his life has become this thing that's like sort of smeared through the way that nothing changes, but everything changes on a day-to-day basis. Really, really complicated and very strange.
And also like in a weird way that's almost like a weird kind of bragging rights for this kind of form, like, oh, I was 16 years, I was like, whatever, I was X years old, and like, this Polish woman like had sex with me, and she brought me like, and like, with a machine. It's like, it seems like a little boy's fantasy that this like foreign woman comes with a gun and like takes you away and like has a sexual relationship. It's just like, there's a weird,
it seems very strange. But it's interesting that he is afraid to essentially step out of the world. He's afraid of like the, you know, when he sees people or when they speak, it's like knives going into him, and he's afraid of the dust and all these things.
Well, because like what's crazy is that at the end we go forward like 5 or 6 years at least from the start to the end, and like when his mom is no longer there and his dad's not around or whatever, he's like, how am I going to eat? It's just like, well, dude, just order food. But like even that is either he just didn't think of it because he's never done it before, or like you're saying, he's just too terrified. But like it's such a simple, like even a thing where like you don't even have to talk to the person.
Yeah.
It's too much for him.
Right. But okay, so let me just finish this thought.
Yeah, sorry.
What's interesting about this to me is that one of the reasons why I think he is so afraid and why the world seems so terrified is because his entire interactions throughout every day creates this unbelievably violent and confrontational world.
Mm-hmm.
Like he just day to day looks at things that are like wildly violent that you would, if you're lucky, never have to confront in your entire life in any context whatsoever, because most of what everyday life is walking down the street and getting pizza and things like that and totally like interacting in a normal way. You're not going to confront somebody drinking acid to kill themselves and watching their bodies get burnt inside out. The toughest part of this book to read is the fantasizing about raping his mother that happens quite frequently throughout the first half of the book, right?
And, but like also coming from the perspective of someone who's like has no idea how any of that works. Like he keeps picturing it as like she's plastic, she's gonna feel like plastic.
Well, it's because his mother is the only woman that actually exists in his life. So she's the only person that he can have sexual fantasies about that exists in a place that's not on screen, right? A lot of the book, at least in the first half, is focused on this idea of whether or not he can get his dick hard and things like that. And he like, you know, there's paragraphs dedicated to him touching himself above and below his sweatpants and all of this stuff. And it, you know, this culminates in him roofying his mom. She goes unconscious and he gropes her when she's unconscious, and he is immediately disgusted because of the feel of a real live body instead of a...
Because this is probably the first person he's touched in years, if not ever, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
Unless the Polish woman actually happened,
unless that woman existed. But the touching of a real live woman might also remind him of the Polish woman.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's this feedback loop here. So he you know, concusses her and then tells her she should go to the hospital. But you get the sense that she really is aware of what happened, because after that point, she doesn't talk to him anymore. Because
up to that point, she's been trying to see him, trying to spend time with him, trying to have conversations, bringing him things. And then he writes, like, she's been distant, she's been cold. She's like, I'm going to stay at the hospital with your father. Like, she knows to some extent that, like, he did something, even if she doesn't know.
And then she's dead. And there's almost no space between those things. It's like she is concussed in the hospital and then she's dead.
Yeah, because his dad has colon cancer, mm-hmm. and so he's spending time in chemo, and she's like, just please spend time with him. That's all he wants, just spend time. And he's like, no. And then she goes to the hospital, and there's like a single sentence like, you know, in the time she was with him, she developed her own. She didn't want to like be a bother, didn't say anything, and she died.
Yeah.
And it's like, oh, quickly.
Yeah. And then his dad dies. His dad dies slipping on the front steps or something, right? It's not mm-hmm. even cancer related. And he's left alone in the house that he's inherited. And he doesn't go to either of his parents' funerals. And he lives off the money that he's been given. I find it I think we step away from realism a little bit here, because I don't think that you'd be able to deal with all of those finances and the house stuff and all that without ever actually interacting with anybody. Because I've been through that, and it's actually, you have to talk to a lot of people, yeah. and you have to sign a lot of papers.
I wonder if it's one of those things where he just has like an online money manager, just like, just deal with it. I trust you. I don't want to talk
maybe,
to you.
Yeah, maybe. I think you still have to sign stuff, and you still have to get things like death certificates, and you have to prove that you're the...
Right. But he like inherits the house on $1 million and basically just seems to spend them all on like chat girls and a sex doll.
Right, which is the extension of like the sex doll is the next movement towards sexuality after he fails with his mother. And then he's also disgusted by the sex doll.
Because it's too realistic.
Yeah, and he cuts it up and throws it in the shower, right?
And pisses on it. And then like lives in it. Like there's a thing like it becomes not surreal, but hyper real or something like for a... Going back to your like world A versus world B, like so much of this is online, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. and then he buys a sex doll. He has to deal with the two people who like drop off the crate, who give him a crowbar because he doesn't have a crowbar. He like touches the doll once, chops it up like you said, puts it in the bathtub. I think he pisses on it. Then all of a sudden, there's like centipedes that like run that bathroom now.
Yeah,
and it's like, wait, is this real? Like, it felt like.
I mean, it might be. I'm not a man that's afraid of centipedes, but like if you're a person that never has to engage with any sort of biological anything, and then all of a sudden there's something that's crawling and has 1,000 legs or 100 legs and is like moving, you know, around in your room, like I could see that as being something that's really terrifying.
And also just be like, just have it, I don't want it, that's your room now.
Yeah exactly, because that's how he treats the house, right? He can go from place to place, like
all the stuff's still there, there's like the different dust, he goes downstairs, it still smells like his parents because he hasn't been down there, like there's been nothing to disturb them in the years since. It's just, it's crazy, but you know.
Yeah, very freaky. I'd say that there are three competing narratives here. One of which is the boards, right?
Just the forums, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Dialogue back and forth among people that are completely anonymous, that we don't know what he's taking part in, except for we know that we can identify him as one person because he asks about the way to get the seal off of a water bottle without it being
right.
So we know that that's him. So we know that he is actually engaging in writing sometimes, but there's no way to tell who's who, as far as I know.
And there's also like in the cam girls, I think he goes by like Chachi something, like Chachi boy or something. It seems to be that because he keeps getting, I don't know, whatever. But yes.
Yeah. We can talk about that a little more in a bit once I look at my notes, which I haven't done yet.
Powerful stuff.
And then so there's the boards or the forums. Mm-hmm. And then you, side note, I once like, lose a friend is dramatic, but like I had a friend that I was really close with. I lived with him in California, and he, like we moved out to California together, and he got really into Coachella. But he like disappeared. He became like a guy that was on the Coachella boards year round for 17 hours a day. He would just be like on the Coachella forums, like talking with people, engaging with them, and like they created a real community. And like when they went to Coachella, it was like now there were like 40 people that you knew that you could party and hang out with. And it's a community of like-minded people with a lot of music and stuff like that. And but it was like, I remember just being like, dude, this is insane. You are spending way too much time. Well,
I think that's the thing. It's like where your perspective is, because like a lot of my I have one sort of group of friends who are all extremely online. I think mostly healthy, but some, you know, whatever. But they've all, like, a lot of them met each other and, like, met their husband or wife on a message board.
Yeah.
And they all, like, this was just the place that they, like, felt, like, you know, because it was a music-based board for, like, NJ, like, you know, punk bands and punk shows or whatever.
Right, yeah, there's a common bond.
Yes.
Right?
I think if you're not in that world, you'd be like, why are you still on that? Like, why are you, like, you're not, but, like, there's friendships and that become real friendships and become real relationships and like married and kids and stuff.
Yeah.
And so I think I'm not saying spending 17 hours a day on the Coachella message board is healthy, but like, to him, it might be the most normal thing in the world.
Yeah, no, I think it was you know, you're doing whatever gives you that, like, oxytocin hit or whatever mm-hmm. it is, or serotonin. Or
he found his people.
I clearly don't know how the brain works. I'm just naming chemicals.
Well, I think it's also, like, I think the surprising thing about that in that situation is that, like, it was a shift. Like, as far as we know, this guy was always
a message. Yeah,
like,
yeah, yeah.
It's not
yeah.
like he was, like, a normal, like, quote-unquote normal. Again, that's not the, mm-hmm. that's the wrong word. But he was, like, a normal kid that, like, just fell down this like 8chan kind of thing. It's like, it seems like he was always here, so
right,
whatever.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So there's three narratives. There's the forums,
there's the forums, then there's the what we'll call World A, right, which is him like actually in his bedroom with his parents bugging him, and he's got his job for the ironically like the mental health services mm-hmm. where he's like doing tech stuff for them, you know. That's like the concrete world that we can like picture him yes. in. We can like create a visual, like I can see his bedroom in my head really well.
It's real sad.
And then there's a third one, which is illustrated in italics, that is a much more abstract and poetic world that is almost feels almost religious in a sense. There's something like ascendant about it. The imagery is very I'm not 100% sure how to put it, but it's like
I had a hard time like placing this, but like picturing this or describing it.
Yeah, exactly. Feels,
it's ethereal. It's like
ethereal. That is the word that I was looking for. Good job.
It's like describing him, but not him.
Yeah, and there's narrative from a video game that he's playing, or that might be him. I'm not really sure. He might be the Henry that he's talking about.
And that the video game, the Henry thing, like, he plays this game, but it seems like no matter what he does, every choice he makes, doesn't. It's like, you can either do this or not, it doesn't have any impact in the game. It feels like the futility of everything.
Yeah, it's incredibly, I would say that this is a nihilistic book.
But here's a. I just thumbed through to find one. In his sleep, he dreamt he was a bumblebee. Fists and feet dipped in wax and flakes, spells conjuring flowers and sore throats, the motions of his extremities monologuing in order for worlds, a blade down behind and vomit feed for gods, his body a caliber for the grid he was measured for, a body plump and tempting crush. It's like, I don't know. Like, it sounds nice. I don't know what that means. I don't yeah. exactly know what it's describing. Yeah. It comes right after a forum post, right before him talking about Victoria, the Polish woman. It's like, I don't know. I like it. I don't know that it. I know it serves a purpose, but I can't really.
Place yeah, it's that. It's imagistic in the way in almost the opposite way as the like series of characters representing websites is. Like in that sense, the language being used evokes an idea within us without us being able to parse what the signifier itself is. Whereas these are signifiers that we're familiar with. We know what all those words mean individually, and when we put them together, it creates almost an anti-narrative. There's no real path to follow, but we can follow what the imagery mean on a sentence by sentence basis, and those images make us feel things and make us react.
I think when it first started, I thought like he had died maybe, and like this was like an afterlife.
Well, this is kind of what I mean by it feels ethereal and almost religious. Yeah. There is like a near religious component to it.
And then like as it went on, I'm just like that's not it, but I didn't have a better idea than that. So
do you remember the one thing that made me laugh out loud in this?
Is it what I texted you about? Well, so every time when I'm reading a book for the podcast, I tend to like it on Kindle because I like to highlight the things. Like it saves it very easily, as opposed to me having like type quotes or whatever. But as I'm reading through here, I'm like I have to like think about a thing that I'm going to type and save later to use in like a specific place on the post. And like all like the really kind of memorable things in the first like half of the book are all like they're memorable because they're horrific. And it's just like that's a very vivid way of like I love the writing, but like I can't put that on our site. Like that's. What the fuck? And then there's one, the first one I found, which is it's in a forum post called Tell Us Your Deepest, Darkest Secret.
Yeah, really and, bad things I don't like that you would never tell your friends.
And some of it's just like, you know, like I was a virgin until I was in college or blah, blah, blah. Or like I killed a man or just like it's some lies, whatever. And then I think it ends a chapter and it just says, I tell all my friends I don't watch Naruto, but actually I watch Naruto.
Which is so funny because it's like it exists in this space where you know, like anime and like the fan dedication to anime is equally as important as like, you know, doxing a girl who like sent nudes once and trying to get her to kill herself. Mm-hmm. Right. Which is like, like that's a very, very dark version of funny.
Well, I think what's also interesting about the portrayal of the worlds, and I don't know what it was that you just said that made me think of this, but like in the Patricia Lockwood book, which we might release after this, depending on how I might shuffle some things around, but in that book she describes like the portal and the dictator. Here there is the computer and the vans. And like they're, again, specific things that have a one meaning, but they're not necessarily... I mean, this is more, I think... There, I guess they're both direct comparisons.
Well, explain what vans is. It's V ampersand, right? Well,
I think in the beginning they write out the actual word vans, but on the forums, people say, hope you don't get V ampersand, vanned, which is like, oh, you're dabbling in truly illegal shit. Like, the feds might show up. They're probably monitoring your computer, and they might show up in the vans and arrest you.
Yeah.
Game over, basically. Mm-hmm. So, but the computer in the vans is like, access to the world and the one enemy, kind of.
Yeah.
As like the portal and the dictator. So okay. Yeah, I think it's kind of interesting like that.
For sure. For sure. On page 15, this is a little personal note here.
Because we also have to talk about the first page 15, because there's a page XV, which we'll talk about. We haven't talked about like maybe the most interesting thing or like the most confusing thing about this.
Yeah,
we'll talk
about that. That's a big thing. Page 15. I remember when I was about 10, I saw some 3-year-old fall out of the shopping cart he was sitting in, and he hit his head on the floor. And I remember in the second before he started crying and his mom began consoling him, they were at a dollar store, et cetera, et cetera. Anyway, this is how I lost my sense of smell.
You fell out of a shopping cart?
Fell out of a shopping cart. Cracked my skull on the ground. Can no longer smell because of it.
When you were 3?
4.
What if
this is a very like was you. very direct line to my actual life right there.
You were like, B.R. Yeager, I feel seen.
I thought it was really funny when someone very casually mentions society's elites, and then another person responds by saying, society's elites, go back to grad school with that crap. Because, like, this idea of... And also, this comes up later. I think it's in the CAMS. But it may be on one of the boards. I don't remember. But, like, it's like, room rules. No politics. Be polite. And it's like, it's so funny to have those rules on the internet where it's like, all of these things are politics.
Yeah.
Like, they're what they mean is don't specifically talk about Donald Trump or don't specifically talk about, like, Democrat or Republican politics. Right. But, like, the misogyny that they're engaging in is political.
Sure.
And like, everything is political. But it's also funny because it's like, why not? Because you don't want these people to argue with each other. Like, it feels like arguing and people having bad feelings towards each other is the worst thing that can happen in this world.
Well, there's also something interesting that's, like, hinted at, I think, in the threat either where the person kills the girl with the wine bottle or maybe later where someone drowns their infant in the bath. Like, there's some horrific shit, but there's, like, one person, like, seriously, is nobody modding anymore? And there's, like, this reference, this allusion to, like, there is someone in charge of keeping this, like, a somewhat safe space. If only safe insofar as, like, we're keeping real shit out of this so that the rest of us don't get taken down because like someone else did like murder
and also
the kid.
And also so that they're not annoyed, because the thing that person is talking about being modding for was someone else asking how to have access to the dark web, right? Which everyone on the board is just like, you fucking noob, like that stuff doesn't matter. Like,
it also feels like it's like almost like a cop, like, hey, how do I get on the dark web?
Yeah,
kids.
Yeah.
Can we talk about the ending?
Sure.
So one of the final things that happens is he buys that sex doll that we talked about. And then there's the forum poster drowning this baby and posting pictures of it, whatever. Centipedes going wild in the bathroom. And then he goes and lies down in the bathtub, either the sex doll bathtub or a different bathtub, I don't remember. He tries to kill himself. And it doesn't work. It doesn't take. The razor is too old or it's a safety razor or something. And he's just like scraping skin off. He doesn't even break the skin.
Yeah, he doesn't know how, because he doesn't have a real razor. He has like a Gillette Sensor Excel.
It's the best man can get.
You can't like... But you can't cut your wrists with that.
No, I think you probably have to whatever. Yeah. I'm not going to teach you how to slit your wrists. But then he just, like, goes back to his computer and finds a site that has, like, 17,000, like, live webcams from around the world and just stares at that. And that's how it ends. Like, he's, like, escaping to the real world. Like, it feels...
Well, but his escape to the real world feels post-apocalyptic because there's nothing much going on.
Well, it feels like a victory of sorts. It also feels like a sad kind of resignation. Like, this is how I'm going to experience the outside world. But yeah, it's like most of the thing is just like, you know, a webcam in a zoo or whatever, and just like there's not even animals on this thing. It's just like there at some point there will be an animal there, but like right now there's nothing. Did you like the ending or no?
Yeah.
Because it's kind of a non-ending, which kind of feels right up your alley.
Sure thing.
Did you like this book overall?
I did, yeah. It gets enormous points for tackling a subject in fiction that I don't think I've seen people tackle before, which is because it's new, right? Who's going to write about this stuff? It's the current generation of writers.
Right.
You're not going to get Thomas Pynchon isn't going to write about this because it's like,
he probably doesn't know about it.
He might, because he wrote The Bleeding Edge, which is a lot of that's about the internet. But the older folks are sure. Not going. There's like a group of people that grew up with this, and because the Something Awful. I mean, I had friends when I was in high school who were on the Something Awful forums, and that was in the 2000s, early 2000s, late 90s.
I never did that. I know of it.
I didn't either, because yeah. It's like I'm like a. You know, kind of a wuss in that, like, it's, I think, pretty easy to make me feel bad by, and like, the last thing that I want to do is see someone committing suicide. Like, I'm not a gore guy at all. I have a tough time dealing with that, to the point where I had a tough time dealing with this book, actually. But that doesn't mean that it wasn't good. It doesn't mean I didn't like it.
I was always, like, interested in, like, Faces of Death or whatever, and I would, like, click the video.
Oh, yeah, I watch Faces of Death.
But then, like, as soon as, like one of those, like, real, like, a decapitation video or whatever, I'm just like, oh, I don't want to see this.
Yeah,
but,
yeah.
Like, I would want to, like, so I could say, like, oh, I started watching or whatever. Like, but, like, I never did that, but I wanted, like, the kind of, like, the...
Well,
it's a social cachet or whatever of like, oh, yeah. I'm not afraid of anything.
Faces of Death is interesting because like this book, like half the shit on Faces of Death is completely fake.
Yeah. Okay. I believe that. So.
Yeah. And then it's like mixed with like news footage of like someone getting their hands cut off in some country that's, you know,
right.
far enough away that we can feel like those people are savages or whatever, you know. Right.
Was there something more you wanted to talk about with the cam girls or no?
There was a thing that I thought was like kind of, you know, made me think is pretty typical about this, which he says there's a cam girl that I think is talking about how she's feels very depressed and near suicidal, and he's like, can you take a picture with some knives? Like, he's trying to get her to go and take out knives and take a picture with him, and then he gets banned, and he says you know, they always banned him even when he was sure they liked it. And it's like, he's sure that they liked it because his entire world exists within his brain and he has no experience of interacting with other people at all. And like, probably, like, I don't know how he would be able to read dishonesty or intent in someone's face.
Well, what's voice. Also, I think what he's maybe misinterpreting, and this is just me reading into it, but like, he's entering, like, there's like a 10-page stretch where he goes in a bunch of different chat rooms or whatever, and it seems like every time he goes in there they're like, oh, you're back,
right?
But that's like the waitress thing. It's like, you're tipping these people, like, their job is to like flirt with you, and you're giving them money.
Yeah, all the people in the world who have ever thought that strippers really liked them or whatever.
And so I think he's like, oh, they really like it because like they're so affectionate toward me when I come in. It's like, yeah, because you're giving them probably more money than anybody else, because like, you just inherited $1 million, have no concept of what that means, have no expenses, and so you can just give the girls online, which by all means do it, please support sex work, but they don't like you for that, and they're not like appreciating you like trolling them and trying to get them to maybe kill themselves. Yeah. Like, yeah,
regardless of what you mean by it, or, you know, like, it, because he is like pretty insistent that he doesn't want them to kill themselves or whatever, but like, yeah, I don't know, it's very weird.
Anything else to talk about with the book, or should we talk about the academic essay?
Let's talk about the academic essay, which is by Edia Canole, I think her name is
Canole. Edia Canole, who is like, what you look up, like a
She's a George Bataille / black metal theorist, which is like interesting.
From like Ireland or something, Dublin, I think.
I think that's it. What's fascinating about this is that you and I both, when we were reading this intro, thought that she was maybe not a real person, that this was B.R. Yeager writing a academic essay to start his book and would contribute to the narrative in a certain way. What are you looking
for? I was looking because, like, it says in here, first published in 2017 by Schism Press, and then it says first edition. And I was trying to see if, like, this was, like, a reprinting. Because as far as we can tell, this is a real person writing an actual essay, bringing literary gravitas to, like, shit posters on 8chan.
Yeah.
In a certain extent. Mm-hmm. And I think when we both thought it was fake, I think the fact that he puts it before makes it feel fake. I think if this was at the end, I'd be like, oh, this is someone actually, like, commenting it. But I think the presentation of this before, and she's quoting passages from the text that we've not read yet, made it feel like, I'm going to be talking about some real lowbrow, like, not really, but, like, I'm going to be talking about some lowbrow stuff over here in the actual text. Let me write this, like, insanely highbrow literary analysis of this thing to, like, highlight the discrepancy, or that, like, everything has value, or whatever reading you want to take from it. But then, like, when you're talking about it, as I was in the middle of it, I'm like, wait, this is it's real. You're like, I Googled her and she's real. Like, it's insane.
It's the interesting thing about it to me is that
insane in a fascinating way. I don't mean that as a negative.
Like, you usually get introductions to books that are like Penguin Classics or mm-hmm. Library of America or something like that. And you get like the Great Expectations that I'm reading right now has an introductory essay by John Irving about how Great Expectations is the book that made him want to be an author. And as you read it, he goes through and he quotes from it and he talks about what's important about different things. But the introduction of the introductions to classic literature are often used to guide your reading of the text in some way.
Yes.
Now, normally these come way after the fact, after there's already been critical, not consensus, but there's like a lot of different people like weighed
decades
in.
Of conversation.
Yeah, decades of conversation, reviews, a bunch of different people saying, we think this, no, we think this. And then you get someone with significant gravitas to come in, like John Irving, and write an essay. And Edie Knoll, I'm not saying that she doesn't have gravitas. She doesn't have name recognition to me, which doesn't mean much because I don't, you know, this world is not my world. I don't know that much about what she's talking about. I'm not that familiar with Georgia Bataille. I know a little bit about black metal, not much. But it's interesting to take that and attach it to a first edition, and not only attach it to a first edition, but attach it before the story of the first edition, so nobody reads the novel itself. There's no critical consensus or critical conversation
right.
about the book before coming in with this academic essay mm-hmm. about the book and its merits and values and the ways in which it, examines the straightforwardness of the worst, right?
Well, what's also crazy to me about this is that this novel is not long. Amygdalatropolis itself is about 150 pages. The yeah. essay is longer than 30 pages. Like, the ratio of, like, what it's analyzing to its analysis is mind-boggling to me. Like, it's so extreme in the ways you're describing and, like, other ways that I'm like, this can't be real. Like, it feels – everything about it seems like this is – the rehearsal, or you know what I mean? Like,
it's placing it in the canon of transgressive literature, right? Georgia Bataille is an important transgressive writer who is writing about sexuality and violence in a way that, like, he's one of the guys that you trace books like this, their lineage back to. So it makes sense to bring in an academic who looks at it from that. And, like, I do think that it's worth turning a very serious academic eye to things like 8chan, because, like, that stuff is way, way, way more indicative of where societal anxieties are than the evening news or sure. whatever. Like, you know, the evening news is for
squares,
middle class adults who are getting cars advertised to them and plaque psoriasis medication.
Well, I think that's something that we've been talking about, not in every episode this season, but in a lot of the different episodes this season, about, like, you need the scaffold, you need the experience, you need to be online to understand the humor. But I don't think that that makes this any more or less valid. I think they're equally – it's the world A versus world B. It's just, like, just because right. our parents and people watching the evening news don't know that 8chan exists, or, like, they saw, like, a 60 Minutes thing on it once 4 years ago about, like, do you know the dark corners of the web? It's just, like – if that's – like, there's – it's not more or less –
which is like they probably only know about, like, the assassin market or whatever, because that's, like, the flashiest story that comes from the dark web.
It's like, oh, yeah, there's no rules. Like, you can get guns and drugs and sex, and, like, there's child trafficking. It's like, well, yeah, but it's also just like they even say in here, it's just like things that aren't on Google. Like, it's just like the unsearchable websites or whatever.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. But I think it's interesting to turn an academic eye to that. What I think is fascinating, and the reason why I thought the introduction was just B.R. Yeager writing in a different voice, is because I think it is rare to try to direct the reading of a text before anyone has ever gotten a chance to read that text.
Yeah.
Like, there's something really interesting aesthetically about that choice.
I mean, it still catches me off guard. Like, thinking about it, I'm just like, I can't believe that that's...
Yeah, it's really... I'm curious about how it came about. I mean...
And then even, like, the two, like... What did they call this? Like, the before... Like, not the dedications, but it's like the quotes that they pull before a text. Is there a word for this page?
Yeah, there is. I would have known it any other time than this exact second that you just asked.
Your amygdala was firing, man.
Yeah.
But, like, even these feel, like, lofty. In a way, it's like,
well, it's the balancing. It's the it's the dialectic between high and low culture, mm-hmm. right? Which is disappearing more and more every single day. And if
in a good way or a bad way,
in a way that is a totally neutral way.
Yeah.
But in a way that also, like, I don't know that it ever there was ever really that much of a difference between it, because it's not like, you know, the Marquis de Sade or Leopold von Sacher-Masoch is like, those guys were both high culture, but also that's where we get sadism and masochism from. Pasolini is high culture. Nobody would argue that Pasolini is not high culture, but you know, you watch that 120 Days of Sodom movie and you're just like, holy fuck, this is like, you know, the amygdalatropolis is within that lineage, right? Of like examining that specific kind of sadism and why certain people embrace it and like why it's important to their essence as human beings.
Yeah, for sure. Anything else you want to read? Egg's email.
Let's give Egg a day in court.
We have an email address, lottery@cageclub.me. I know that we have some new listeners who are going back to check things out, because I think this season has been very accessible. We've talked about this not on mic, but like, it's very accessible. We have a lot of great author interviews. And it feels like for a topic that's extremely online, there's a natural tendency, like, for people, like, because there's some
who are online to engage with it. But also because it's the most, you know, most of the authors that we're reading are, because they're writing about online, they're people who are alive and writing right now, and you can actually engage with them on the internet and on Twitter. You can at them. They, because of the decline of stature in literature in America, you're more likely to get through to them than you would have been able to get through to someone like Norman Mailer or something like
I think also, like, to their credit, a lot of them just have their DMs open. Like, I'm just like, not even having to at people, I'm just like sliding into those DMs.
because they're online in a way that they're aware of,
because it's the internet's value
to culture.
Yes. So we have an email, lottery@cageclub.me. If you're listening to this episode or any episode you want to write in about this book or any book, lottery@cageclub.me. We'll read on the next episode. But our friend Egg wrote in Meg's reaction to Amygdalatropolis. This book, Egg says, was interesting. I don't think that this email is going to be very long, because I'd like to stop thinking about this book as soon as possible.
I mean, honestly, like, kind of same.
Yeah, I mean,
I find that the things that I try to stop thinking about are the things that I keep on thinking about, though. So, you know.
I think that there's incredible value. Like, I'm glad, obviously, that we read this. I think that it's important to talk about this kind of thing.
Yeah.
Would I rather not have to picture some of the horrific stuff in there? Yeah, absolutely. But, like, you know. The act of reading this book, Egg says, made me feel ill, but it was interesting in that it never seemed to cast moral judgment on the main character. It felt like A Clockwork Orange in that it felt like the exploration of violence. I can also appreciate the fact that the prose within the novel was quite beautiful, even though the content itself was horrific.
Which is, that's a tough thing to pull off, right? It's not like the prose in American Psycho is not beautiful. It's very, like,
clinical?
Clinical, yeah. He's not like going for poetry. He's just going for, like, the blunt explanations of blood and guts.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas I think Yeager does a good job here of weaving between the typo-laden internet speak and that sort of ethereal, poetic, religious mode.
Yeah. Ooh, not all in all. In short.
Oh, shit.
Mixing it up.
Changing it up.
In short, I can appreciate the strength of the book, but I don't think I'd ever be able to bring myself to recommend it to anyone else.
We gotta teach Meg something about brand consistency.
Come on, Egg.
No, I mean, that's interesting too, whether or not you would recommend this book to other people, because you recommend this book to another person and they read it and then they think, like, you're a psychopath.
Yeah.
or why did you thrust that upon mm-hmm. me? Why did you make me read that thing?
Once actually halfway through this, I'm like, oh, Egg probably hates this.
Yeah, I thought she would too. It's interesting because it's a book that I really liked.
Mm-hmm.
It's a book that if anybody that read it said to me, I didn't finish that book, I had to put it down, I'd be like, I totally get that. Yeah, totally. No problem.
But I think it's mercifully short in that regard. It's not like it's 700 pages of this.
That's true.
Like, you're in and you're out and you're whatever. Let me try to give Matt a call. What do you think this, what is this cover?
I think it's an amygdala. Amygdala.
Yeah?
I think so.
Okay. Let's give Matt a call. See if he's around for
Sunday. He's not going to be around.
He's texting on the thread. That doesn't mean anything.
Hey, you've reached Matt.
Phone off or do not disturb mode.
Probably doing work.
Well, we'll get Matt on the next episode. We have patreon.com/lotterypod, at lotterypod on Twitter, email lottery@cageclub.me, and like the first judicial...
I have one more thing to say about the book, which is going to
keep reading.
It's going to come off kind of harsh because it's the last thing that I'm saying about it, and it's like my biggest criticism
yes.
of the text, which is that these might be true. I don't know because I'm not part of it, but it like definitely like trucks in a lot of stereotypes of the people that like of the main character hits all of the notes that we stereotypically sure. think of yes. these folks as. So in doing so, it doesn't really provide us with insight into these people because he's really just confirming all the things that
it would have been interesting if it was like a handsome, well-spoken, affluent, like the opposite, or like a woman.
Yeah, but it does. Yeah, it's I don't know that that's a criticism, but it's something that like, you know, it doesn't. I don't think it's giving us insight into this character necessarily because it is dealing with all of the things that we already think about these people: incels who are homeschooled, who, you know, are actually afraid of the world when they're talking real big from behind a computer.
I think if you do it with someone who's not the stereotypical incel, this, you know, teenage white boy, that's what this becomes about.
Yeah.
It's right. Like, oh, women can be incels too. It's like,
yeah.
Did you not
yeah, read yeah.
anything else?
It becomes maybe not as interesting because then it becomes a sort of apologia for the white male yeah. or something like that, which we don't, you know, I think is probably lame. Do.
I thought you were setting up that final thought as a way to just give your crime and cut me off without saying keep reading.
I would never do that.
You do that.
Joey, I would never, ever.
Juridical postulate?
I would never do that.
Judicial
today's,
postulate?
Today's crime is bootlegging CDs.